So thank you very much, everybody, for coming out tonight on Wednesday. Certainly a few quick thank yous for this evening's festivities. First, John D'Amico, who's put this all together in terms of the location, and Amanda Carlson, who's very efficient and very good at putting all the specifics together. Also, Amanda Beach, Beatriz Cortez, Alicia Manzano, and Anna de Beauvoir, okay? All key players in this process. Anyway, my name is James Wilchin. I'm part of the domain Aesthetics and Politics at CalArts, and it's my very great pleasure to introduce to you Claire Colebrook, who's going to talk on becoming photographic of cinema. Let me read a little bit about her bio. Claire is the Edwin Erle Sparks Professor of English at Penn State. She has written books and articles on literary theory, feminist theory, contemporary European philosophy, poetry, visual culture, and queer theory. She is the author of New Literary Histories, Ethics and Representation, Deleuze, A Guide for the Perplexed, Gilles Deleuze, Understanding Deleuze, Irony in the Work of Philosophy, Gender Irony, Milton, Evil and Literary History, Deleuze and the Meaning of Life, and William Blake and Digital Aesthetics, okay? All I can highly recommend. She co-authored Theory in the Disappearing Future with Tom Cohen and Jay Hills Miller, and co-edited Deleuze and Feminist Theory with Ian Buchanan, Deleuze and History with Jeff Bell, Deleuze and Gender with Jamie Weinstein, and Deleuze and Law with Rosie Briadotti and Patrick Hannafin. She's a co-editor with Tom Cohen of a series of monographs for Open Humanities Press. I really recommend going to that website. Great stuff there. It's called one of the volumes is called Critical Climate Change, or that's the edition. She recently completed two books on extinction for Open Humanities Press, The Death of the Posthuman, and Sex After Life. She's now completing a book on Fragility of the Species, the Archive, and the Earth. Well, after all that, I take great honor in presenting Claire Colebrook.
Thanks for inviting me here, and thanks to the list of persons to whom you also gave thanks. This is part of I'm going to try and give a summary of a very long, and when I read it on the plane, overly dense argument. So I read through the text and thought, it's coming out in print in quite a few months. So I'm going to try and give a summary of it, and I'm hoping I won't ramble. The other thing I'm going to try and avoid is one of the strands that runs through the argument as a whole is a discussion of Gilles Deleuze and Bernard Stiegler and their relationship, the relationship between photography and cinema. And of course the problem with that is there's an element of it, if you're interested in Deleuze, it's just interesting, right? I'm just talking about Deleuze and it's part of Deleuze scholarship. If you're not interested in Deleuze, it's just not that interesting. So I'm trying to avoid that without skirting things over too quickly. So I'm going to try and give the skeleton or framework of where I want to go, and then if something's too quick or too unclear, hopefully you'll do me the courtesy of asking me a question about that. So here's the problem in a sort of hierarchy, the top problem that looks very abstract, but I hope it's not, which is the relationship between philosophy, cinema, and photography. And the first one of those that I want to talk about, philosophy, I think should be interesting, even if one's not interested in philosophy. I used to work in a philosophy department, I left that ages ago, but what I mean by philosophy is not so much particular books on philosophy, but the problem of how we ought to think. So that's what I think philosophy is. I think even in its most boring, dry, narrow, redundant moments, it assumes that there is a proper way of thinking, and that unfortunately not everyone's performing thinking properly. So that philosophy, and this is a terrible way to talk, and I condemn any undergraduate from doing it, but I'm about to do it. From its very inception, philosophy has asked about how we ought to think, with the assumption that there's a lot of humans thinking that aren't thinking properly. And I think that that's, even though the state of philosophy today might not be as healthy as it should, I think that's a very crucial problem, particularly when we look around and we hear all the complaints about what's happening to the brain in terms of social media, what's happening to the brain in terms of politics, why are these people being so stupid? Why are people not thinking? Why are people not thinking properly? So that's the philosophy part of the argument. Second part of the argument, which is the cinema argument, is that, again, this is a terribly broad claim, that philosophy has always had a relationship to cinema, and by that I mean a relationship to images and moving images, images and moving images. So that what I want to do is look at those three terms, philosophy, cinema, and photography, in terms of how we should think, or, and I think this is the bigger question, how is it possible that a philosopher can tell us, people that we think we're thinking, that we're not thinking properly? And actually, I noticed one of the escalators I was going down, it must have been the airport, it's the only time I really, so one of the, had a picture of a brain, and it had emotion, cognition, and it was saying, we're looking at, and it was for an investment company, a banking investment company. We're looking at the way people make decisions and deciding why they make irrational decisions. So there's this notion of a tutoring in thinking, and that it has an intrinsic relation to the relationship between the human brain, the human eye, and the image. So I want to give, this is why I'm interested in the work of both Gilles Deleuze and Stiegler, because they make two distinct arguments about the ways in which the advent of cinema transforms that question that's always been philosophical. I hope that makes sense. So that if philosophy has always been how we ought to think and why we don't think in the manner that we ought to think, something about cinema allows us to see that question more clearly, more properly. So I apologize to the people who know a lot about Deleuze here, but I'm hoping I'm not just going to be doing gospel Deleuze. Outside of that, I want to say that the relationship between between photography, which is the still image, and cinema, which is the moving or connected image, is crucial to this problem. On the one hand, I want to reinforce Deleuze and Stiegler's arguments about why cinema is important, but also, and here's what I really want to do, question why there's a privilege of the moving image over the still image. Why philosophers like Stiegler and Deleuze, but beyond that, why cinema has this quality of provoking good thinking with far less attention paid to photography. And I think that's because there's a certain privilege connected to a certain model of thinking which ought to be questioned. Okay, so this is some old Deleuzian territory, but I'm going to go over it just to establish where I want to go. So for Deleuze, and I think the Deleuze that I'm mostly going to draw on in what follows, is unfortunately, well, why I say unfortunately, is the Deleuze of Deleuze and Guattari in What is Philosophy. And the reason why I say unfortunately is because the Guattari people hate people like me who just say Deleuze when it's Deleuze and Guattari, and they neglect the role he played and don't really know enough about Guattari to say about anything about, and I'm just going to be guilty of that. But the Guattari industry is hotting up now anyway, it doesn't need me to contribute to it. So the two distinct claims made by Deleuze and Stiegler with regard to cinema is that, first, there is an intrinsic tendency in humans, not animals, but in humans, towards stupidity. That's part of the first part of the claim. An animal can't be stupid. And this relates here, try telling that to my pet collie when he's, but anyway, that's another thing. I think he's quite capable of being stupid. But in this particular sense, and Stiegler's written on Deleuze's argument about stupidity, only humans can fail to think in the manner that they are capable of thinking. So only humans can fail to think and realize something of which they are capable. So when an animal just thinks, in its animalistic terms, it's just being the animal that it is. What does it mean to say humans have a capacity to not think in an animal manner? And this is where cinema comes in, is directly tied to the image. We, and I think this is I think it's very problematic when we say we humans, so I'm not endorsing it. It's like a we always has scare quotes or French quotes. That we have a capacity to release images from the organic reactions of our body. So just to use a really crude example from cinema, if I'm watching a horror film and I see a knife going into a throat and I flinch, that's an organic, visceral reaction. My body's reacting immediately to what's occurring to my eye. If, however, I think I have some capacity to think about pain, I go away, I write a philosophical dissertation on what pain might be, what it might be to watch pain, to feel empathy or sympathy for pain. I've released what I've seen from my organic reaction, I've released it from the present, and I'm also projecting it into not just the future of like, what if someone gets knifed in the next hour, but what it would be to feel pain, what it would be to see pain, what is pain? So it's in this respect that in What is Philosophy, Deleuze and Guattari talk about science, philosophy and art. I'm not going to talk about science. But they talk about concepts such as, let's say I've just said pain, you know, one wouldn't be that hurts. But one could start asking about pain, and I think as a person who does long distance running, there is that very interesting threshold which one's pursuing something, one begins to think, is this pain, why does one subject to pain? What is the threshold of pain? What does it mean to tolerate pain? At that point, the concept is detached from the immediacy of the present and takes on an autonomy such that if I then write a book about it, it could be read 10 years from now, 5 years from now, so on. The same applies to percepts. What would it mean to see something and then think about that visibility, that possibility of seeing into time? Now, for Deleuze, the reason why cinema is crucial to this release of thinking from my body. Okay, this is the why cinema releases thinking from mere organicism. Does that make sense? So if the animal is just merely driven by its body, humans have this potentiality to see or think in a manner that's virtual or intensive. It's not in the here and now, it's not in extended space. It is what it would be to think, what it would be to see. For Deleuze, the reason why this happens occurs in two stages. The first is that by cinema freeing vision from a human eye or human point of view can start to take hold of the images that are not from the point of view of an observer. Now, the problem is, of course, well, it's not a problem. Everyone knows that most cinema that we see is taken from the point of view of an observer and is probably organic. We feel sympathy for the characters, we feel pain, we flinch. So when Deleuze talks about the possibility of cinema, what he's really referring to is cinema that is cutting into narrative, organic sympathy. Most of his references are from high avant-garde films, not all of them, but where there is a disruption of the relationship between the eye in the present and some form of narrative or organic time. And here's what I think is interesting, even though Deleuze is privileging cinema, that cinema that will make us think beyond our mere bodily responses, he's privileging a cinema that's fragmented or cut up or that disturbs narrative and disturbs, if you like, sympathy, empathy. There's a famous film review program on Australian TV where they rate the films according to the degree to which you could identify with the characters. So if it's a good film, if you feel that the characters were realistic and you could identify with them. If you put a minus sign in front of that rating, you'd get the Deleuzean theory of cinema. The cinema's good to the degree to which it creates some form of disidentification or cut. Here's my short preamble on Stiegler, which I'm going to talk about four concepts. The first, and this is what I'm going to draw upon a little more seriously, is the concept of archaic cinema, or that there was always a form of cinema before cinema came along. Very simply, the argument is this. In order to be human, or again, not to be stupid, in order to have a relationship to the present that's not immediately driven by drives or immediate responses, the more images I have at my disposal, the more things I've seen, the more things I've taken in, gives me a more complex relationship to the present. Any of you who know philosophy can see that there's a debt to Henri Bergson, for whom the more memory I have, the immediacy of the present has more possibility. So if, again, going back to the difference between animal intelligence and human intelligence, if an animal sees food, it eats, presumably. Anyone who has a pet knows that's not true. But for the classic example for someone like Stiegler, it is, and the reference from Bergson is to Proust, an item of food or a taste can draw back a memory of a place, it can then give you a sense of what memory is, and then bring up in a whole sense of time. But for Stiegler, the important thing is that well before there was philosophy written down, and his first work goes back to the cave paintings of Lascaux, is that the trajectory of human history has been one of the continual storage and continual memory of images. And the concept he uses to explain this is what he refers to as epiphylogenesis, so that the species through its history inherits an increasingly richer archive of images. And in doing so, any individual that is born in the present has a relationship not just to the here and now, but a whole history of images and texts that allows that individual to have an increasingly complex relationship to the present. So the individual isn't driven by drives, but has those drives rendered more complex, delayed, projected into a future because of an archive of images. Stiegler refers to this as trans-individuation. If I didn't have an archive, if I didn't read anything, if I didn't see anything, I would just be me. But the more I read, the more highly specific I become. Everyone has a different archive, everyone has a different set of memories. Diagnosing the present, Stiegler refers to what he often refers to is a proletarian, I don't think I've ever pronounced it, I've only written it or read it, proletarianization of the senses. That is, and here's his diagnosis, we are now so bombarded and captivated by images that instead of having this complex relation to the archive, which delays the drive and helps us to think in more complex ways, we are once again becoming like animals, stupid. I think anyone in animal studies should have a problem with that. What I want to draw attention to is the problem of someone, anyone, diagnosing a condition of thinking. And it's not just Deleuze or Stiegler, there's any number of, if you're on Facebook, it's funny because if you're on Facebook, there's any number of articles that come in about how social media is decaying our intelligence or how spending too much time on your iPhone is decaying. And I've read tons of these articles and I know I've got every one of them from Facebook. How attention spans are shortening, intelligence is shortening, captivation. And here's my interesting point. Part of the diagnosis is that we are now developing shorter and shorter attention spans, being captivated by short images and not creating broader, semantic, meaningful syntheses of that would create a genuine understanding. So there's a just to conclude this part, there's a diagnosis of stupidity. There's always been a diagnosis of human stupidity. It has a relationship between us, between the immediacy of the image and the capacity of the image to release us from the present, and most importantly, for both Deleuze and Stiegler, but I think for nearly everyone, the organicism of the present, that is our bodies, our needs, and our drives. There is a capacity in the human to not be animal. I don't know. Well, I want to question why that's such a problem. That if all the archive were destroyed tomorrow and we lost the capacity to think in ways that recalled the Platonic dialogues, I think it would be a loss for us because that's how we define ourselves. You know, if I had to live a world in which there wasn't Deleuze, I'd be pretty empty, but I think that's intrinsic to me and not intrinsic to the human. So that's fine. Okay, so this is where I want to talk about philosophy more generally, outside Deleuze and Stiegler, privileging a certain relationship to the moving image. And I want to just, and I know this is sort of heavy-handed and overly broad, I just want to draw attention to the one bit of philosophy I'm sure we all know, which is Plato's cave allegory, where, and it's interesting, slaves, so it's the image of the slave, chained, looking at, in a darkened room, looking at projected images, and actually feeling quite content until they're dragged out to look at the light that's projecting those images. Feeling actually that that's pretty uncomfortable, so not wanting to be released from the passivity of just watching images, but being turned, and the phrase is turning the soul around to be released from being captivation to looking at the origin of images. That's a classic philosophical image or figure that wants to demarcate how humans tend to think from how they ought to think, that's the first thing, but also wants to do so by privileging a turn towards the origin or dynamism of images, from away from fixed images to the source of images. And I want to say it's almost from the still image to the moving image. And I don't want to go through the whole of the history of philosophy, but I do want to say that at any time there's been a discussion of the relationship between thinking, I would say this occurs in Descartes, occurs in Spinoza, it occurs in all the canonical texts of Western philosophy, and I do want to make a point that this is a not accidentally a Western point, that there's always a complex relationship between the moving image, the still image, and the turning away of the human from what it tends to be towards what it ought to be. The argument tends to go like this. There's a tendency towards being captivated by still or inert images. And I think, no, I don't think, I'm certain that one sees this today in every journalistic lament about tabloid culture, Facebook culture, Instagram culture, reality TV culture. There's a critique of an inert captivation that needs to be rendered more complex by some form of temporal connection. So even though it's Stiegler who uses the phrase, the short circuiting of attention, I think he's picking up on something that has much broader resonance. I don't think that in itself is problematic. What I do want to focus on is an almost moralistic relationship between still images and moving images. And I want to do that into the different ways we might look at the relationship between politics and art more generally. So just to recap, when Deleuze talks about cinema, more specifically in his two books on cinema, he makes a distinction between two types of image, the organic, well, many types of image. The two I want to draw attention to is his distinction between the organic image and the crystalline image, the second of which he privileges over the first. The first, I mean, for Deleuze, all cinema has the capacity to make us think about how it is that perception connects images through time, how the flow of time is composed from movement, and so on. But the distinction he wants to make between the organic image and the crystalline image is where he thinks cinema, and therefore thinking, arrives at its proper potential. The organic image still ties movement and the flow of images to something like life or the earth. And I want to sort of explain this. Perhaps now I'll start to look at some cinematic examples. I'm going to use is the most unremarkable and boring example of a film I could have chosen. And what's my defense for that? My defense for that is this. I was trying to think of a political film that was criticized for being apolitical. So, and the first one that came to mind was Apocalypse Now, because the claim, and I bet we've all read different things about this, but the claim that influenced me when I heard it was that it turns, and I've got three sections of the film I want to show that I had marked. So it turns what should be, and here's where I want to start talking about the relationship between politics, art, and the image. And I've heard this about so many texts, so this is where I'm coming from. It takes a highly political, historical event that needs to be understood in terms of capitalism, the economy, geopolitics, and at the end of the film, which I'm going to start showing now. So this is, I'm just going to cue forward. Cue forward and hope this works. So I'm going to cue towards, I think it needs to get my hard drive that was playing before. So I'm going to keep talking while I try and find. Sorry, can you turn the lights up again? We didn't cue this. Ah. And now it's telling me. How's that possible? Did that before? That's weird. Sorry. The scene I'm about to show is the end of the film where, and I'm assuming most of us know this film pretty well and also know, in theory, the book. Let's see if this works. Try me. Disaster alert. Even though I bet you all probably know the three moments that I'm going to show. So this is towards the end of the film. This is when I want to talk about what it is to depoliticize something by way of cinema. So let's see if we can. You could completely depoliticize it by not being able to play. Maybe I should try and quit and start again. Maybe we should just stay with that shot. We did cue it up. Unless I get this. Greta? Get back in. Let's see what. Isn't it great how young people know about technology? I'm assuming I can make ages of comments like that. Being aged. So this is the final scenes of the film where Martin Sheen, and I always refer to him as Charlie Sheen, but the other one, has travelled up to the end of the what in the book, Heart of Darkness, is the Belgian Congo, but now this is the end.
Thank you. wasn't even in their fucking army anymore. Everybody wanted me to do it. Him most of all. I felt like he was up there, waiting for me to take the pain away. He just wanted to go out like a soldier, standing up. Not like some poor, wasted, rag-ass renegade. Even the jungle wanted him dead. And that's who he really took his orders from, anyway.
Takes what's a political event, the Vietnam War, which we all know had its own particular narrative and explanatory history, and turns it into something timeless, atavistic, sacrificial, and therefore depoliticizes it. And the same, anyone who's been brought up in a literature department knows the same thing occurs in readings of the novel Heart of Darkness, that one shouldn't read Comrade's Heart of Darkness about a metaphysical confrontation with evil, but needs to see it as a narrative of colonialism, Belgian and British colonialism in the Belgian Congo. Now, what I want to question is, first, what it means to say that doing something like this is depoliticizing when I agree with the diagnosis that by splicing that image into an otherwise narrative film about someone who's traveling to meet someone at the end, and then it goes, as it were, completely freeform at the end, and loses all narrative dimension and starts moving into scenes of sacrifice and, as it were, primitivism, is to perhaps raise a deeper question about what it is to think politically. That is, and this is where I go back to, to begin with, a Deleuzean approach to cinema, that there's something about what those sorts of scenes doing that break into narrative, historical, or what we think of as political coherence, in order to ask the question of how something like, not just the Vietnam War, but capitalism, slavery, the whole geopolitics of the relationship between the West and Asia emerge. Just to make this more, I think, specific, but probably heavy-handed, this is the scene that I guess is probably more famous, less subtle, even though that last scene was hardly what you'd call subtle. This is from the middle of the film. In fact, it's right at the center of the film. It's the second of the three clips that... I think it's not highly original of me to say that the helicopter that's coming in is also the light of the projector. So that the images that, what I'm trying to say is that rather than say that the film should be about politics, should be giving a narrative, is to reverse this and say that the whole narrative of politics is already cinematic. So this is the second political ways to read that scene. One is, and this is a common criticism of the film of Apocalypse Now, is that this is all, and probably American Vietnam War films more generally, is this is always how the Vietnamese are represented, as in not at all. So that's one, that this is a drama about America's projection of colonialism, the fact that the Playboy bunnies are dressed as cowboys, Indians, and an American soldier, so that there's the projection of American history. But what I think another way of reading this is that there's something actually, and this is where I want to sort of start concluding by thinking what it would be not to be captivated by moving images, and I realize this is quite beginning to get quite dicey, but to start thinking about a sort of privilege of captivated stupidity, that to look at this world of history, colonialism and empire from the outside without any understanding of where it's coming from, that this is a non-cinematic point of view that's submerged within the film, which can't make sense. So I sort of want to elevate what is ostensibly a highly racist, colonialist figure of the stupefied, and this is why I think the end of the film animalizes the Vietnamese, like by putting them in with the scene of animal sacrifice, cuts them off from historical understanding, presents Vietnam as this place outside history. And if you recall the dialogue in that last scene, it says the jungle, it was a terrible dialogue when you think about it, the jungle wanted him dead, that's who he took his orders from anyway. There's one way of, this is the corruption of civilization that's fall back into primitivism or atavism. Whereas I think, and you know, I don't want to talk about intention because we're not allowed to anyway, but I think, I mean, if you're in a literature department, you're not allowed to, and I guess that's where I am. So I won't talk about intention, but I will talk about the way this film can read politics in two dimensions. One is the properly political understanding of an image or an event is to place it within a broader context of history, human-on-human relationships, capital, geopolitics, and that's, and in that sense, I guess, probably this film fails and also is highly racist in placing these people completely outside that understanding. They're objects, not subjects. But what I want to suggest is that one detaches oneself from the fetish of narrative, synthesis, making images move, looking at the origin of images, or going back, looking at the light from which images are emerged, and becoming, well, this sounds too Deleuzean, becoming stupid. Looking at this as if it had no value, no sense, and if all of it was swept away, it would mean nothing to me, them, us. That's all very problematic. Here's the, here's the last image I want to look at, which is a still image. It's probably, I was a child when this image was already circulating. Probably one of the most famous images from the Vietnam War. Now there's two ways to understand it. The first, as I've already suggested, is that the only way to read this image is within a narrative, historical, political context of which you're all American, maybe most of you are American, doesn't need explanation. And one would be, I guess, mildly horrified. If one were teaching a class on political photography and one's students didn't know anything about the Vietnam War or thought it occurred in the 19th century. That's how I used to feel. And then I began to think what it would mean to look at this still image without a sense of narrative, without a sense of politics as it's usually understood. And I want to move towards, this is my concluding point, move towards a different understanding of politics. The one I want to get rid of is, if you like, a politics of the moving image or the synthesized image. That proper thinking is about turning back to the origin, the genesis, the emergence, the history of things in order to understand how they came to be, if you like a sort of diagnostic or intuitive gaze. And the other would be, again, a probably too crude an expression, a sort of animal stupidity of politics, where something in this still photograph, it's a photograph, it strikes me, it's not, again, going back to my terrible horror film example, you don't look at it and feel pain. I don't even know whether you see pain. I think what you see is exposure. It's a photograph about exposure, so it's an exposure about exposure. And here to make the point perhaps even more crudely, I think if one has an, as it were, small p political understanding of this, one can narrate it, one can give it a narrative in terms of the Vietnam War, certain political practices, and then feel pretty good about being on the other side. As that were, one could walk away from a film about the Vietnam War and think that America was evil and that we don't exist on that side. Well, the rest of the world, I don't know if few Americans know this, the rest of the world likes having America to think that you people are the evil imperialists and we're the colonizers. I know this happens not to be true. But the point would be to free these images, to see them as still, to see them as detached, to see them as if one didn't know what they mean, and then confront the very possibility of human exposure, human fragility, and human pain from which those then narrative, political, imperial experiment events occur. So what I want to suggest is that when one talks about the politics of art, it should, and this I guess I'm being moralistic, politics of art should, on the contrary, not be about the synthesization, the making sense, the rendering coherent or historical of events, but actually detaching them from what we think is a political narrative to ask about how the possibility of their emergence, going back to the last scenes from Apocalypse Now, rather than see the film as just dismissing the Vietnam War because humans have always been evil, or dismissing the Vietnam War because there's a basic human propensity for evil. That's seen as a deep politicizing gesture, but rather cutting that event off from its standard political narrative and looking at the potentiality from which events like imperialism, war, and then in turn Vietnam emerge. So this is a politics, this is my last sort of point, this is a politics that is not of the polity. So it's a politics not of the polity, but it's about a politics of human exposure, about human fragility, and rather than thinking about it being the tendency of humans not to think, there's another phrase from Deleuze I'd like to conclude with, which is actually a phrase I believe Prima Levi and Hannah Arendt also used, so I think he took it from, which is the shame of being a human being. So the shame of being a human being, the potentiality that exposes us to the events that subsequently can be narrated as political. Thank you.
Okay, questions?
Thank you very much. Just a question. I mean, did I understood you correctly? You tried to rescue photography for philosophy and politics with Deleuze. Was this the what you tried in your lecture? So my question would be, because what I know of Deleuze, there seems to be in his writings quite a hatred of photography.
Yes.
Right? So I think of the Kafka book where he speaks of photography in terms of cliches and stereotypes.
Yeah.
In the cinema books, there's a passage, in the second cinema book, there's a passage on Ozu, the Japanese filmmaker, where you have this so-called pillow shots, so like long takes of non-moving, nothing moves in the image. And Deleuze says something like, the moment where the photograph, or the cinematic and the photographic image seems to be, in a way, very similar, this is exactly the point of absolute demarcation of the cinematic and the photographic image, because what moves there is time itself, right?
Yeah.
And I think in the book on Francis Bacon, he almost treats Bacon like a kind of filmmaker, right?
Yes.
In a way, because speaks about the bleeding out of the colors, of the metamorphosis of the body, which is, I think, always a problem of movement, and movement is mutation in a way, or evolution.
Yeah.
So from a philosophical standpoint, photography would be non-philosophical, because for Deleuze it's the becoming stupid.
Correct.
Right? But
yes.
You try to do something new, which I was very interested in.
Okay, so, and I didn't know.
And how would this, elaborate on the point on how to rescue
Deleuze from
how to rescue photography with Deleuze of making photography non-stupid in a way?
Or thinking that maybe, okay, so there's several parts. The first is, I didn't want to go down in the direct, like when I said there's a part of this paper that's all about Deleuze, and if you're interested in Deleuze, which someone like you is, then it becomes very interesting, but I didn't want to burn everyone off on that. But I will say this, if you look at why, okay, I'm going to try and do this as clearly and succinctly as possible. Bergson says cinema's terrible, right? Cinema's bad because it gives us an image of thinking that I see one thing. That's not how the brain works, right? There's a constant source of motion. And so Deleuze says to Bergson, actually, you should have loved cinema, right? You just had a lousy understanding of cinema, right? And I think that's what I would say to Deleuze in photography, because if you look at the cinema he likes, right, when he elevates in the cinema books, it's not the cinema that stays in constant synthesis, connected motion. I was just running out of time. The cinema he likes is when it's like random photograph, random photograph, random photograph, and all of a sudden there's no natural synthesis, there's no natural connection, there's no narrative, there's no coherence. So what you've done is taken a film and chopped it up, right? And again, we could go on, like I could not write the book on this, but there could be a book written on how when Bergson says, the problem with people is they think the mind is like a cinematic camera. It just takes pictures and connects them all together. Deleuze says, well, you had a lousy understanding of cinema, and if you'd maybe watched, the right thing, and you didn't understand, here's his thing, you didn't understand the components, right? They're not still shots. They're fragments of movement, and then if you looked at cinema properly, you'd see the world was made up of movement. And then, here's my bigger point, there's this unquestioning moralism about movement and time. You'd understand time, you know, time in its pure state, time. And then, my 2 points, the Deleuzean thing is, actually the bits of cinema he likes are when it becomes photographic, right? When it freezes, when it stops, and suddenly it's non-narrative, it's non-semantic, and there's almost as though you need a moment of stupidity, right, in order to start thinking, right? I mean, we all know that from, if we teach or, I mean, some, you know, you're teaching something, you're trying to convince a student, like, blah, 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 and then the student says, yeah, but, you know, like, I don't get it, and you actually think, they're probably not getting it, because it's not such good. You know, there's a sort of, and I want to go back to philosophical wonder, so, yes, that's what I'm trying to do in two senses. The bits of cinema he likes are actually moments of immobility, and he never theorized that because there was this fetish about time and dynamism, which I then think, my second point would be, there's a Eurocentrism attached to that, to a thinking that's historical, right, as opposed to a sort of punctuated understanding of what thinking might be.
May I just briefly add something? I mean, that sounds very similar to me, this kind of affirmation of the stupidity of photography, in a way, in the contrary position to Deleuze and French theory would be Roland Barthes, of course. Roland Barthes, who prefers the photographic over the filmic, etc., of course, in this last. And there you have also this Barthesian idea of the punctum is, in a way, I thought exactly also what you were talking about. The punctum is something which disconnects image from narrative, from making meaning in a way, and it becomes in a way stupid. So the punctum is the kind of becoming stupid.
Except the only thing I would say about that, and we don't want to get too much into the one of my most symptomatic phrases from Roland Barthes, and I know it's earlier, myth is frozen history. To me, that's symptomatic of, say, stupid people just look at, you know, stupid people just look at an image. What we really need to do is connect it to a broader history and a privilege of synthesis and dynamism. So, I mean, there's a one could go on about. I have another theory about Roland Barthes from that one, but I agree with you, it sounds like that, but I'm going to say no, it's not that, precisely because there's this fetishized understanding, fetishization, that politics, that art should be politics, and politics is history, and politics is the form of history that takes stupid people that just look at stuff and have an affair, you know, and it gives it some form of genetic component, its emergence, the condition of its emergence.
I just had a question about your comments earlier about the archive and in like relationship to becoming stupid. It seemed like I was just thinking this possibility that like becoming stupid is also anti-archival.
Very.
Right.
Yeah.
But I forgot whether you were for the archival.
No, it is anti-archival, and I'll tell you why in two senses. There's a pop culture lamentation about the emergence of a generation that will be incapacitated with reading the archive, right? And I want to know, actually we're having a brief discussion about Bret Easton Ellis earlier, so I'll use that as an example. If you read a book by Bret Easton Ellis, like American Psycho, it mentions Whitney Houston, Huey Lewis and the News, stuff that, imagine some English professor, should there be such things, teaching that in 50 years, right, the way we're teaching James Joyce's Ulysses. What do you do? Do you have the Norton anthology of American Psycho, where you have a footnote to Huey Lewis in the news? I mean, maybe I'm the only old person old enough to unfortunately remember that garbage, right? And his brand names when you read that book, you think, you almost wonder if, well, obviously if that understanding goes, you know, I'm not heartbroken. At what point does teaching Ulysses or a portrait of the artist of the young man become impossible, right? At what point do you just, well, I reached that point. I've stopped teaching it because there is no way the students are going to pick up that there's a section of irony that's directly resonant of Flaubert. There's just no way. Now, am I depressed about that? Well, yes, if I'm worried about my job, right? Now, to turn that into a bigger, this is why I wanted to look at the picture of the Vietnamese looking through the, you know, let's say all of this stuff that we hold so dear. I agree with Stiegler that I am absolutely constituted by that archive, such that the thought of a world in which humans, once again, right, or maybe the only people left are hunter-gathering humans, right, maybe that makes me depressed as hell, right, because I have a narcissistic and parochial interest in that type of humanity, right? But I think, this is why I think it's becoming stupid, does one really want to say, and I'm thinking about these horrifically apocalyptic laments you're getting from French intellectuals, right, about the becoming stupid of the population. Now, I'm not saying that Facebook is Plato's Republic. But I'm not sure that that's such a bad thing, you know, that when we talk about the end of reading, you know, we should think that the number of humans that did this, like if you added up all the history of humans, the number of humans that did close reading is what, this many? And then my bigger argument would be, and at what cost, right? So I think I agree with Stiegler that the who I am is profoundly constituted through a trans-individual archive. And I just think one should not have a narcissistic, Western, colonialist, imperialist attachment to our archive. Yeah.
I was just adding on to that. I was wondering if, because you kind of always becoming stupid as, this complete blankness, but, isn't there also, selective stupidity? Like, you could make selective forgetting.
Uh-huh.
Have certain parts of the archive disappear so you can rewrite things and...
Yes. And I think I don't know why I'm being so personal, you know, anecdotal. But, you know, when you read this stuff, when I read, 80s deconstruction when I was in Australia, and I didn't know any of it, right? You just read this stuff, I just read this stuff like it just came in a book from the library. I didn't know all this stuff. And of course it was a bad and stupid reading, but I'm sort of glad that it was. And I do think that what it might mean to read a book out of context, for example. And I think, to go back to say the book from which this is the film, Heart of Darkness, I think the standard way of teaching that now is as a post-colonial text about Belgian imperialism, and to read it as a metaphysical novel is a very bad thing to do. But I think one could have, actually I like the phrase about selective stupidity, what would it be to read this as if one, you know, found it and didn't know anything? Maybe it would also have no value too. That's the things that we canonize as well would be interesting in that regard. Because, you know, again, sometimes when you're teaching, you feel like saying to your students, hey, I know you don't like this, I don't like it either, but shut up, it's the canon. If you don't know this, you're in trouble. And I'm beginning to think, you know, selective stupidity. big way to think about it.
Well, then I'll ask a couple of quick things. One, when you're talking about the photograph, in some ways, being an interesting augmentation of cinema or against it, clashing. What is that? What does that notion of the photograph do to Deleuze's notion of time? In other words, well, how do you see time? Because obviously, cinema for him, you know, is the shift from the movement image to the time image. It opens up a whole different kind of time. Okay.
Yeah.
And are you linking the photograph then to irrational cuts? Okay. So
yes.
Time and irrational cuts would be my first question. The second question. It seems like what's fundamental for your analysis of that photograph was the question of exposure.
Yes.
And what kind of, how do you, I'd like to see you run out that notion, the concept of exposure further, okay?
Yeah, so there was like 5 pages on exposure and negatives, right? So that was just, there's no way I could improvise that at a Patrick Brennan movie. So incredibly bored. Here's what I sort of know and want to argue for certain is, as I was saying in response to your question, that the time that cinema becomes what it properly is when it's invaded by something like the photograph. So that, you know, his analysis of the Hiroshima Mon Amour, when this image just comes in and disrupts what would be the cinematic eye. And that is the irrational cut, right? And that when he's writing the history of cinema, which, let's say if you look at his sections on, well, at least, you know, montage would still be putting images together such that that then implied a history and a broader movement, and then as it goes later and later, the cuts become irrational, and then you get, I think fairly obviously a privilege attached to forms of cinema that had this notion of time in its pure state, right? And time in its pure state is, time in its pure state is, and then I'll just finish the sentence. Time in its pure state would be not the time it is for our perceiving consciousness, not the time for something going through time, but what it would be for infinite movements to be going through their own fluctuation, all out of sync with each other. Now, here's where I want to pose a question, not about the privilege of, so first thing, you've got a privilege, in there you've got a privilege of the human, right? So that it's, animals are not capable of irrational cuts, right? It's only because, this is connects to Stiegel, it's only because humans have technology, they have machines that are capable of connecting images outside of the human eye, that you have something outside the human flow of time. Once you get something out, a being that's capable of thinking a flow of time that's not its own can think time in its pure state. And all I wonder about that, and this is a project I'm working on, is whether there's not, I think there's a very narrow European privilege of time, right, and synthesis, and that there are modes of thought that would be far more moral about space, right? So that there's a moralism attached to time. Okay, does that? I know I'm saying too much too quickly, but I think I wonder why the pinnacle of thinking is time in its pure state. And why then a whole philosophy of ethics and politics comes with that. And I just think it ought to be questioned. I'm not there yet, but I think one ought to privilege white time in its pure state. And I think it has to, I think it has to do with a certain diagnosis of human stupidity that's not as innocent as it might first look. Right. And that's why I guess that's why I really got gripped by that image in Apocalypse Now, because it seemed to be typical of a people without temporality, right? And they're looking on stupidly, right? But it means nothing to them, right? I don't think it's a negative image or a stereotyped image, but I think it's food for thought, yeah.
I guess this question, I'd like to ask it in a more interesting way, but I can't figure out how to do it right now. I'm curious about the relationship between the note you sort of left us on about, against the making historical and the synthesize, and thinking about the potentiality of being a human being, which makes events emerge, and the relationship between that idea and its privileging of the photograph and some of your other work on extinction and ecological catastrophe. And I'm trying to tease out the connection in my own mind, and I see something, but it's not there for me still yet.
Okay.
And so I'm wondering.
I think this relates back to the other question in some ways between, like, so what? Do you privilege the archive? Do you not privilege the archive, right? The problem with human extinction, it seems to me, is the horror, the absolute horror, of thinking of a world in which there's no thinking, right? And I think I could cite examples more than I could care to mention, where there is a prima facie value attached to us, right? And when I say us, I actually don't mean humans as a species. I mean to a particular fragment of humanity that's constituted itself through an archive, that's formed a concept of humanity in general, that's built attachment to itself as a species. Right. And in order to give you maybe two examples that make that clear, one is if you go back to sort of medieval literature, there's a notion that, you know, you're walking along, there's a plague, we're probably all going to die, you know, we're all going to die tomorrow, right, in a way that pretty disastrous, but it's not the end of the species, right, it's just, and us, who we all are, going to die tomorrow. There's no sense, well, we're all going to go, but there's the humans over there that will. It's not, it's just like, this could all end, right? This could all end. And that's an sense of exposure and fragility, and that's my first example. And yet we are so, if you look at films that are supposedly the end of the world, right, end of world films, they're not the end of the world. They're end of the white Western, the number of end of the world films that are set in Manhattan, right, from Day After Tomorrow, Cloverfield. It's the end of this world for us, right? The fact that 99.9% of humans over the whole of existence face the end of the world, right? Just the end of the world, right? But it's, so the first thing I want to say is that stupidity is to get away from this prima facie attachment to us, right? And then my other anecdotal notion is I was in this round table that New Formations did in London, which is, you know, London's probably like here, you know, there's everyone's got a PhD and 5 books and they're working at McDonald's or something like that, you know. And so, like, they have this round table and it's me and Eric Allier's and Nick Tobin. So all the political Deleuzians, and I'm the token female. And the guy that's asking the questions turns to Eric Allier and says, But you know, the problem with Deleuze is, you know, if you really followed the path of his thinking, you know, all humans have become extinct and that would be a good thing. Now, actually, I don't think that's a good reading of Deleuze, right? There we go, so everyone was, that's so ridiculous. And I actually thought, well, not as crazy as all that, is it? You know, why do we think that this is the horror of all horrors, right? Not just the suffering of, like, that individual event, the suffering, right? But that there's something, that's why I finished with a quotation, which I think is a sort of strand in Deleuze when he says the shame of being human, right? Not, the stuff about stupidity is actually a moral imperative not to be stupid. Right. So that's the one strand of his thought, right? That one should watch more Godard and read more Nietzsche. But there's the other, the shame of being human, which is to, I'm not one of these people, they do exist, that's part of the human extinction movement, right? That we should stop it now. Because I do think we have a quite interesting parochial attachment to our own type, right? I would like humanities departments to continue existing. Right? I would like philosophy to continue exist because I'm in a humanities department and I read philosophy. But one shouldn't then be talking about that as the potentiality of the human, right? That if it's lost, that is something, it's parochial, right? And just because it's parochial doesn't mean it's bad. But it doesn't mean it gives us a prima facie right to geoengineer or any of the other crazy things that will supposedly save us because we are of such incredible value.
Thank you.
I'm interested in memory and the construction of memory. Especially as an artist, I'm interested in visually evoking a certain construction of memory that comes through the visual. And I'm interested in the idea that you discussed at the beginning of your talk about this disciplinarian parochial space of philosophy as a way that reifies humanism and that reproduces the idea that humanity has to perform a certain type of reason in order for it to be recognized, especially because when you're talking about the archive, then there's a possibility of looking at the archive as the archive of reason that's written down and that's recognized in that disciplinarian space. But also the oral archive of memory that's evoked through images and in functions in a more fluctuating or nomadic form and evoked by images. And so I'm interested in what you have to say about this because I know that more than once I've been in a crisis thinking that memory is a concept that's kind of like solidifying our understanding of life in the past instead of looking at the future, and I'm interested in this possibility that this other archive that's, let's say this archive that's stupid, quote unquote, is the archive of, that's able to cut through the archive of reason and then build a memory that connects to a future where reason is, this reason, but this parochial reason is not the only understanding of memory.
I think this is an answer, right? So there's archive and there's archive, right? Yeah. So the concept of archive I was sort of endorsing and trashing at the same time was this trans-individuation archive. So that when I read Plato, right? I'm not reading some marks I found on the beach. I'm reading it as someone who said something back then, right? That was then written on by, you know, subsequently. And the more I read, the more complex nor should I have a time, which would then, of course, give me a far more complex future, right? So that the only possibility of a future is if I have some complex past. But maybe I would want to draw a sense to a different type of archive. And I know I really want to find another way of doing this without talking about Australian Aboriginal art, because something seems to me too easy about just shifting to Indigenous thought, right? Because, but it's at least one, I'm not privileging it and saying, I just want to say that there's at least another way of thinking about memory, right? So that the way traditional, but it's now feeding into the future, the way traditional Indigenous art operates is, and I guess most of you have seen some of it, you know, it's every painting is a map, right? So it looks like a series of dots, but if you ask who painted it, it's this is where, and it's pre-human memory, right? This is where the lizard was got overly thirsty and drank from the river that was owned by the snake, and as a consequence turned into an emu. I mean, that's terrible, right? But that's the, and if you ask what that is, it actually gives you a map of a certain area, and it explains why the river turns down this way, right? And then that painting, it's not really, right, gets repeated, and if you ask, when did this happen, right? That's like there, right, over there, right? It explains a place, right? The even better thing is if I then plagiarize that painting, right? I copy it and repeat it. That's not plagiarism for them. That's like, geez, that's all. It's like when you see a copy of your article's been downloaded, right? You don't think someone stole anything. Someone's reading it, right? And even better than that, when the Australian airline Qantas put Aboriginal dot paintings on the side of their planes, and you think, oh my God, this is, you know, terrible capitalist appropriation. The actual was like, well, no, it's just being repeated and circulated, right? And it was deemed to be, this was the interesting thing for me, it was deemed to be memory, right? It was an image of memory that was spatial, right? And dynamic, right? So that actually now if you look at contemporary Australian art, it will have things like disused, broken down cars, right? So there's this middle of this dot painting, and then and of course in the Aboriginal art market, there are people who don't want to buy that stuff, because when they want to go back to Europe with their Aboriginal painting, they want it to be the lizard, the rock, the river, they don't want, and the rusty old car, and the tent, and the welfare office, right, which is there. But it's a way, so what I think there are different forms of archive and different forms of memory, and I think one of the ways in which one might think of like a memory into the future is to not be so, again I say, parochially attached to our own memory and our own archive, right? There are different forms of, and I'm just becoming aware of this more and more because I'm so narrowly trained in Western literature, Western art, right? You know, and I think we think of that as like the archive, right? And it would be completely shattered if one just took a lateral movement, right? And I think that would give maybe an unrecognizable future or a different future. I don't know.
Well, I'm the number one then. In Death of the Posthuman, you talk about the ethics of extinction. And, you know, you've just been talking in some ways about how you're not for total extinction of humanity, they say.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if you'd elaborate a little more on what the ethics of extinction, because it does seem embedded in that is this notion of this, not necessarily, I think you say, there's not a death drive per se, but there is this rapaciousness and this sort of tremendous destructive force that seems to be embedded in humanity at some level.
Right.
And it could be Western humanity, but I would say that it seems like that's a pretty much a general proposition around the planet. Okay? I mean, at least in most major centers, you can see it, certainly historically. So, if, I mean, you can comment on that too, I'm just making a point there. But what is that, how do you see that rapaciousness, that destructive capacity that seems to be bringing humanity through climate, through consumption,
right.
I think you talked about the difference between nuclear war, which would have been like a heart attack, and we're now more like a stroke, we're going through a slow witnessing of the destruction of the eco, at least the habitat that we take for, so maybe you can elaborate on that.
There's extinction, there's extinction and there's extinction, right? And I think there's the flux and flow of extinction, and then you get the great extinction events when there's a massive acceleration. I think what's different here is that there's a way of life for which extinction is embedded, right? So we can't, and this is a terrible, I hate this, we can't sit here with the lights on, with my Mac, Googling. We just can't do that. It's not sustainable, right? And the whole edifice that, the very possibility that allows me to read and write and think in a condition of leisure is precisely what destroyed the planet, loads of other humans, loads of other non-humans. So it is the case that one can't point to a golden society in which there's no destructiveness. It is the case that I think we should question why there's a terror at humans becoming inhuman, right? Whatever that means, right? Being merely stupid, because the attachment to non-stupidity has probably not, if you were a utilitarian, which I'm not, if you added up the amount of pleasure and pain that thinking has generated, it's probably not going to come out well for us. What I think is interesting in terms of an ethics of extinction is losing a whole vocabulary of sustainability, survival, mitigation, adaptation, and so on, that does two things. It has a prima facie attachment to what we are now without recognizing the intrinsic drive to extinction that's within the culture that's trying to save itself. So, and then once that is taken into account, I think the question of the future should not be how we survive or how we sustain ourselves, but what questions other than survival and sustainability would we be able to think about at this stage, right? Because it's not like I can say, there's a book by a South African philosopher called Better Never To Have Been, who says that actually the human species should just self-extinguish, right? We're not worth. And I think that suffers from the philosophical disease of being told something, recognizing its logic. And this is what some philosophers, analytic. You're told it, you recognize the logic. Oh, it's better for me not to have been. Okay, I'll just stop there, right? We do have this attachment to ourselves, right? And I think that living out the end days of the species is probably more about questioning what it is about ourselves that we're attached to, or what we would say. Even if there's nothing we can say, what would we say? So what would be what would be rendered worthy of not going extinct? And it certainly wouldn't be, you know, there's this Future of Humanity Institute in Oxford where the whatever money the UK government is pouring into research, which is close to nothing, is going towards how we keep thinking alive, right? And I think of all the things we would want to sustain into the future, would it be a machine that keeps doing logic? And I'm questioning that is the case.
Anybody else? Well, that might be a good place to end on the question of the future and what you should think about cultivating. Thank you very much.
Maybe you could announce that she will be speaking at the Red Cup on Friday?
Yes. Where Colebrook will be giving the keynote speech or talk on Friday at Red Cap in